أعوذ بالله السميع العليم من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. في البداية كنت أريد أن أتكلم باللغة العربية.
But I wanted to speak in Arabic, but I think people are following us in French online, so they asked us to speak in French. I'll be speaking in French, and then we will finish this.
Français. وشيء طيب للجميع أن تعرفوا المركز يتكلم, يعني نتكلم هنا في المركز بثلاث لغات.
Languages. I will be speaking in French. There is simultaneous interpreting into Arabic. First of all, I would like to thank the interpreters for their effort. And on your behalf, I would like to thank Dr. Fathi, who headed the committee, the organizing committee of this conference, with the help of Dr. Mawahib, Mr. Shawqi, Badi'a, and all of them. I would like you to thank them all. Of course, I should not forget to thank the CAN network, CAL Alumni Network. I thank them too for their participation, and we pray to Almighty God that our cooperation will continue. And we would like to thank the provost of the university who came with us, and we also have some publications, and by the will of God, in September we will launch an MA program in Islamic ethics. This is a first by all accounts. And in fact, in dealing with academic cooperation with BRIL, I thank all who participate with us, Dr. Muhammad Ghali. The message that Kyle wants to spread, and you may have noticed that I will go through in a few minutes and through the themes that we have dealt with in this conference. The first challenge is a methodological one, and how we should approach dealing with questions relating to ethics. And Dr. Fathi Hassan Malkawi and his opinion as to how to move from Western traditions into Islamic traditions, and to establish a hierarchy here. And we need to be self-aware and come up with the kind of definition. Also, professor, they are all professors and doctors, so I refer them all doctors or professors. And of course, I respect them all, and if I use the wrong title, please forgive me. The way we deal with the prime objectives, the maqasid, we need to some new line in thinking so far as the methodology is concerned, the way we deal with jurisprudence issues to understand these maqasid or prime objectives. Dr. Ismail Hassan elaborated on that and the challenges we face. There is an internal challenge to categorize these disciplines and sciences, and also the bridges we should lay down with other issues and relating to other disciplines like humanities. And It was said that some of you may have had some doubts about this debate, but what Dr. Mu'taz al-Khatib has emphasized in his presentation, that this kind of relationship is there, and we should really use that and take our positions vis-a-vis this. When we discuss ethics, there is a problem. Even as Muslims, we refer back to Abdullah Draz, who tried to present a system to organize Draz's maybe amongst the very few, or maybe the only scholar who knew about Islamic ethics, and what Kant and Bergson and others have said. This was in the beginning of the last century. Of course, it's not easy to refer back to Hobbes or Ross, because their thought is more complex than what we understand. We cannot say Shaykh Hobbes, for example, and we cannot say that peace comes before ethics. He doesn't say that, but he presents that in a special political context, and we should be careful that when a scholar places security first, for example, this may not be his position, prime position, but this is his response to a certain context. Ibn Taymiyyah does not have one kind of thought. He has a developing process of thought, and according to different contexts, in certain phase, Ibn Taymiyyah criticizes Greek philosophy, and he says there is a huge issue with dealing with that. Dr. Mu'taz said that justice as an absolute value. This is a real question. Is justice an absolute value, or is it peace, and how can we compare? Because value can be absolute in its objective, but relative in its value, and justice can sometimes make peace a negative value. But if we take the opposite, and we say it is absolute, and it will be relative in comparison. So we really need to simplify some of these issues. I liked what Mu'taz said, and this requires us to do a lot when it comes to coming up with definitions. I wish and hope that some of the impressions which come from Islamic spiritualities, it's no coincidence that Muhammad Iqbal's thought is related to philosophy, and because he is aware of Western thought, and Sufism or Tasawwuf, mysticism requires us to prioritize which is a prime objective, maqsad, or what is a priority, awlawiya. When we deal in the realm of spirituality, when we want to liberate our soul and understand the concept of tawheed, the oneness of God and closeness to Allah, this, of course, will be looked at in relation to the values, and asking what is tawheed. And when, for example, we say when a man in the beginning of the classical phase who wants us to make values a prime objective and not a means, for example, In our consideration of ethics, we can consider the aspect. In Islam, of course, does not allow for looking at values from a utilitarian point of view. So we must look at it in this context, and we must go back to our legacy, which asked us to look critically at our own history. And it's not an insult to say that a certain sheikh was influenced to political reality, and there is no harm in saying that in his response to that context, but because we are not insulting him, we respect him, but we look at him as a human being, and we criticize his thought, not his person. And this is the methodology which we should adopt, regardless of which phase we're talking about. And what Dr. Mu'tas said was important when he said that historical simplification, when we talk about Ahkam al-Sultaniya, it's not a structural thing, but it is a context which raises fundamental issues. If we reduce that, this will be a huge risk. We really ought to review our traditions and our legacy in light of contemporary contexts and issues, and also we should not leave them captive to the perspective of history. As for the political aspect, in what Professor Fareed Ishaq, when he posed the following question, what should be obligatory on a government, or describe a government that is an Islamic government, or its policies? For me, a description doesn't matter. What matters is the essence, is the core values. Are we talking about justice, or structure here? Because we, in a certain period in our history, the Quran, for example, says their affairs should be dealt with on the basis of consultation, shura. Here we are not talking about the ruler, we are talking here about our priority is the people and consulting people. This is not the structure. The problem is when we got to the monarchies and royal families, we forgot the people, and turning balance upside down here is catastrophic. Even with some Islamist movements, they started their thought from the people, then later on changed their focus into the state. So Muslims should be aware that they are running the risk here. They are running the risk when they replace the principle with the historical example, and instead of the contextual principle. I like what Dr. Shangiti said when he balanced between the French Revolution and he took us back to the terminology which are in now in currency. We can pose another question. Should we, from an Islamic point of view, should Islamize the structure, or pose a question about what is the end result, what's the meaning of the structure? In our understanding of a state, is the state as a historical example should be questioned or not? We, in a methodological manner, we should question the Islamic nature or not of this structure. There is another question. For this reason, I liked Dr. Salman Bounaman's contribution, and that is to do with innovation. If we can creative thinking, if we only think of the Islamization of the structure, then we're narrowing the creativity aspect, which we suffer from a weakness in anyway. This takes us back to what Dr. Kramer said, Professor Kramer, that even that creativity requires courage to say what can Islam offer. Now, if we go back to what Mawardi has said, or other scholars have said in the past, if we only confine ourselves to that, we will stop ourselves from a third path, and that is political courage to question our reality based on our contemporary thought. And also, Dr. Bunaman said something important, that being transgressed against and does the person who is wronged have to be a Muslim so that we can support them? Dictatorship should be, it's imperative on us to fight it, because it's a dictatorship, because God Almighty said we have ennobled humanity and human beings regardless of their religion or nationality or whatever. And this is the debate on Syria now. Those who were on the side on the wrong people and historically know that they historically used to support the dictatorship in Syria. So therefore we should all be courageous, and we should also pose these questions and the way we deal with this dilemma. Another thing in this morning's the problem with these conferences is that, for example, from the point of view of participants, maybe the standard is below what they expect, and from point of view of the public, it's too specialized, either too general or too specialized. And it's difficult to strike a balance between the two when it comes to consanguineous marriage and other related issues. Consanguineous marriage, this is a real problem. We have the scientific knowledge, and of course there is the margin of the scientific probabilities. And maybe, and there is a 25% probability that there can be congenital diseases or hereditary diseases. So therefore, the ethical consideration here is subject to scientific consideration, because the scientific reality here is not an inevitability, but it is based on the way we calculate this probabilities. When there is permissibility, this is not a comparative thing, not an imperative, sorry. So there is flexibility here. I'm almost finished. Where did I stop? Remind me, please. I said that this is a license or a permission. It is not an obligation. We cannot say it's haram because the Quran allows it, and we cannot say it is an obligation as long as it's not conclusive or categoric. But today we have a new scientific piece of information which can contribute to the debate. The problem is, should we follow religious permission or scientific knowledge? And we should avoid falling into the trap of having to choose. I saw that this morning, and in all debates on ethics, for example, Muslims often look at anything scientific as coming from the West, and anything Islamic or religious as coming from the East, and this is narrowing the issue down in a manner which should not be, because reality is more complex, and science contributes to our knowledge, and it questions our Islamic ethics, and our acceptance of rationality. When Laurel said that if you have consanguineous marriages, there is the likelihood of some hereditary diseases occurring, but scientifically speaking, we have ways of controlling that through premarital tests. This is a kind of rationality that we can apply. We can measure science and vis-a-vis religion and vice versa. For example, when we still debate, should we determine the first day of Ramadan through observation by the naked eye, or should we make a calculation, scientific calculation? So we still are trying to decide. We are still in a state of confusion between science and our legacy. In the past, Muslim scholars approach science with a rational, common sense approach. Sometimes, nowadays, we don't do that. This morning, the debate was very informative. What Fuad Shaaban said, be careful. Because we have this complex vis-a-vis the Western scientific knowledge, we should not look at that as an absolute thing. Knowledge is economy, it is power, so we use some of it to have some sort of relationship, but we should not treat it as something sacred. We should think critically, and in the West, there is more criticism of science than what there is in the Arab world. But sometimes we're not aware of that, but our interpreters are with us on this. I think they are. I'll close by a question posed by Dr. Ghali. For example, in the approach by Dr. Abdul Haq Hamish, I do not follow an approach of reductionism and look at everything from the point of view of jurisprudence. Our problem is when we let jurisprudence penetrate other issues like that. I finally close by saying that I want to emphasize strongly, and this is when it comes to my conditions on the role of this center. I want this center to have a role to play in issues relating to refugee issues and immigration, because this is an international issue, and there is no country which can lecture other countries just like that. I am, as a European, I feel embarrassed somewhat in what we do towards the immigrants, and what Dr. Ray said, we use different descriptions of refugees and Syrian refugees, And we forget that we are talking about human beings who are fleeing bombs and areas of conflict. And we know that the death boats from Tunisia and European approach has not changed, except when we saw the image of that little boy who was thrown into the shores by the waters of that sea where he met his death. I as a Muslim, I feel ashamed. I say, similar to what Sami Hanifi has said, Muslims are not doing enough. Muslims were tried and found wanting when it comes to the question of refugees. They still supporting a dictatorial regime. Here, nobody wants to accept refugees. And I'm not talking about Qatar. And this is not a source of shame. If there's any Muslim who defends this position, it frightens me. As a European and as a Muslim, this is impossible. We have to name things what they are, and the statistics are very informative. Are we all guilty? Yes, we are. We are all guilty, and we should all take a more courageous discourse and not hide behind words or statistics. Today, the question of immigration and refugees will not allow us to lecture and preach others. And what Dr. Hanafi said is true. He was right in what he said. This is a multidimensional issue, and the issue of refugee and migration should bring us back to other questions of citizenship. When we bring people here to build the country, what values do you have? These are questions we have to pose them courageously. And I, as a person who is the director of an Islamic ethics center, and if there is no courage to pose the questions like that, we should close down our centers and find another job to do.
This is also very fundamental. We have a reflection that looks at the inside, but also it refuses simplifying things and how we look at text in relation to other things. We have to do that, and there are people who have entered into this kind of context. And in addition to that, we are very lucky to have Dr. Professor Ray, who has talked about this issue, who studies this issue and the reality, the relationship between this issue and reality. The issue of migration is very complex and very intricate indeed. We're talking about different countries between the different political contexts, but the complexity of this matter does not allow us to deny the issue. That is why we have to engage in this matter very seriously and also to talk about issues of finality. My conclusion, after thanking you all and thanking all those who follow us on internet, I mentioned you in thanking the different people working with us and those who are following us. So there are thousands of people following us on internet through the live screening. Our vision is very important, and from the very beginning we said something: these questions from Islam are not going to be solved only through Muslims or amongst Muslims, we need to have the consciousness of men and women. Some of them are agnostic, some of them are Buddhist, some of them are Christians, some of them are atheists. We have invited them all in order to keep on this dialogue. What is very necessary here is to have a clear understanding of the questions posed. This clear understanding entails that we understand the complexity of the matter. There are so many discussions taking place. That is why we need to have to develop a certain methodology. So first we have to understand the complexity of the matter, and after that we have to have a methodology, and also we have to set the objective of all that, because we have to look into the ethical dimension and the finality of the mission of the matter. Three things that we need to do. We have to Islamize the means and not the ends. We have to think about the structure, and we have to concentrate on the means. This is a major methodological defect. This is a kind of a reductionist kind of endeavor. We have to try to have a discussion with the other civilizations and with ourselves. We have to enlarge this relationship with others and with ourselves. The second thing, we have to reflect on ourselves and how are we going to adapt to reality through creativity, through courage, through rethinking our heritage as a force of contribution and not only a space of adaptation. The third thing, I keep on repeating this, if there is one thing that is very important when it has to do with monotheism, this is a center in which Islam is a light. It is a light that does not switch off other lights. It is a light that invites other lights. This is very important. Indeed, there is another thing in that light. It is a light that is very truthful in all its dimensions. And I think we need to do a little bit more dhikr and also more relationship with the essential. And what is more important also, we have to pay heed to the fact that we should not not be able to distinguish between the means and the ends. Ethics and fiqh are means. Political engagement is a means. So we have to concentrate on that. Once the means becomes the end, this means shirk. That means that we have changed the position of the center of gravity. Thank you very much. May God help us in our endeavor. Thank you so much. I would like to give the floor now to the MC, Dr. Ashraf Qiti, and may the peace and blessings of God be upon you all. Thank you.